Alright, I'm going to take a quick look at the Dragonlink mini receiver. I received this one a few days ago and just getting around to it now, but it's a nice little receiver. Small. A lot smaller than full size. I think they're 12 channel, the regular standard ones. You also get a micro USB port built onto the receiver, which is nice for updating firmware and changing some settings, because there actually is some configuration software that works with these. You can map channels, change a few, you can put whatever channels you want on each bank of pins there, which is handy. Because there's only eight banks here. Their default are channel 1 through 8, or if you enable PPM, is on channel 7, and you get a standard RSSI on channel 8. Pretty much what you would expect. You still have the standard little update connectors, and you have this extra one here. I'm not sure what it is yet. I don't think it's used yet. But you don't really need to use these if you use a USB. And besides that, it came with one of the newer Dragonlink antennas. These are pretty nice. I've shown these in the video before. I like them. They tend to work. I don't know. I think they do work slightly better than the old just standard dipoles. Split the cable at the end. It's got a little coil there for better matching. But either way, I mean, it works. Get a couple of plastic tubes, clear plastic tubes, which you slide onto the wire, and onto here you notice there's two little slots there, two little notches, which are for cable ties. You get four cable ties. Put two on each plastic tube to hold it on there. Pretty much what you'd expect with that. But getting back to the receiver though, that's the important part. First thing you'll want to do is get you a micro USB cable, which I already have plugged into my laptop. The other end is just a standard micro USB. Use these, a lot of cameras and cell phones, stuff like that, use them now. Don't get one with the receiver, but you should have one later on. If not, you can pick them up for a couple of dollars. They're not much. One end's already plugged into my laptop there. You'll notice you plug the other end straight into the receiver. And you can see the LEDs, they power up. You might have heard it connect to my laptop, which now we'll need to install a driver, which we'll get to now. All right, and forgive me for filming my screen with my camera, but I'm kind of in a hurry and a little bit lazy and didn't want to set up a screen capture software, so we'll do it this way. As I said, have my receiver connected to USB. It's powered up. Other end's plugged into the laptop. So the first thing you want to do is this software. You can actually download this from Dragonlink's website, and it comes with the files you see here. You get the version 1.5 and 1.6 beta firmware in this particular one. You get a USB driver, an alternative signed USB driver. You get a folder with old versions of the firmware, and you get a PDF, which is your quick instructions, and your release note with changes to your software. So once you have that unzipped in a folder on your desktop, you want to open your device manager. And this is Windows 8, by the way. Open your device manager, and you'll notice you have Dragonlink micro receiver with a yellow exclamation mark by it. So you want to right click it, click update driver software, browse my computer for driver software, browse, navigate to the Dragonlink micro receiver folder, which is sitting on my desktop. And in Windows 8, you want the driver alternative sign folder. Select that one, click OK, click Next. Windows installs software and names it the LPC USB VCOM port. Close. Check that it's installed properly, which this one is on COM3, so we're good to go. And close this, and you can open your configuration software, which is in the driver folder for whichever version is on your receiver. I'm not sure what version was on this one when it was shipped. The first thing I did when I got it out of the pack was update it to the newest 1.6 beta. But so you want to open the config software, which is, in my case, Dragonlink config v16.exe. Open it. and you'll notice a micro receiver connected. It tells you it has firmware version 1.6, so we're good to go. And from this screen, you can set what type of failsafe you want. You want normal failsafe, which is just like your old Dragonlink receivers. You set your position using the button on the transmitter to store your failsafe positions, which is the one I use. I've always used it, don't plan on changing it. You can set no output, where it will stop all your PPM, PWM outputs on all your channels. I think, like, one thing comes to mind, the NAS32, I think when it detects a loss in PPM signal, it'll load its own failsafe values. You could go that route. You'd select no output, so when your Dragonlink receiver lost its signal, it would just stop all outputs, then the NAS would take over. Just one example, but like I said, I don't use that method, but if you want, it's there. Or the third option, keep position, which is basically like some of your older standard RC receivers would hold the last position that, you know, the last good signal it received, whatever position your servos are in, it just holds it in that position until it gets another good signal, which worked okay for line of sight flying and stuff with momentary fail safes. You know, it tend to do okay, but like I said, I prefer your normal method where you set each channel what position you want, which I usually center my controls and trigger return to home. And if I don't have if my OSD is not controlling the throttle, then I'll usually set a cruise throttle and, you know, just do it that way, the way I've always done it. So I'm going to leave that on normal. And like I said, you can map your channels here, which, like I showed you, they're marked on the receiver. You have channel 1 through 8, which is your 8 signal pins. And you can set what you want to output on each one. You can have channel 1 through 12, or your digital RSSI, or SBUS, or PPM on any one of these channels, 1 through 7. And channel 8, you also have the option for analog RSSI, which is what I use with my OSD, so I'll output RSSI there. And PPM on channel 7 is fine. And if I wanted to, I could run my, just say if I'm going to use a pan and tilt on channel 7 and 8, which I do in one of my airplanes, a Skywalker, I think, and maybe my Skyhunter. But either way, if you want it 7 and 8, and you don't, and your channel 7 and 8 banks are used with PPM and RSSI, you could map channel, say, channel 7 on bank 5 and channel 8 on bank 6, for example. And then you'd hit save settings, and you can see here it says your config save, loading config for verification, and it loads your configuration and just double checks, and, you know, it verifies that the receiver actually stored those. We're going to set those back to defaults right now, channel 5 and 6, and save those. And you can also map what channels you want on what position in your PPM output. It's just like the changing the actual physical outputs, but you're mapping them in your PPM signal. You can, you know, position 1 through 12, you can map it to channel 1 through 12 or digital RSSI on any one of these positions. And you can also set if you want an 8 channel or 12 channel PPM out, which I'm using a Futaba transmitter, so I only have 8 channel PPM going in, so I'll leave it on 8 channel going out. And over here you can enable your beacon, which is a UHF signal which is transmitted to help you locate a downed aircraft. For example, when your receiver goes into failsafe, which it's currently set to 300 seconds before enable the beacon, which is 5 minutes. And it looks like it should be a drop down option, but mine is grayed out. I haven't read about that. I don't know if it's just a future option that they haven't enabled yet, but for now 5 minutes is fine, and mine's grayed out, so I'll have to leave it there. Don't really have a choice. But you can select what frequency you want it on, 425 through 440 megahertz. I've set mine on 425 for now and enabled it. You have unmodulated or modulated, which again I haven't read to see what that option means. I'm not sure. I'll leave it on unmodulated for now. And over here you have your RF protocol, which is your V2 normal or your V2 1280 megahertz friendly, which for the V2 Dragonlink V2 transmitters, there's a your standard firmware or your 1280 megahertz friendly firmware, which moves the channels away from any channel that'll have a harmonic on 1280 megahertz directly. They move away from those just to reduce your chance of getting noise in your 1280 megahertz video. I'm using standard protocol on my transmitter right now, flying on 1258, and haven't had a problem with that, so I'll leave it and select the normal protocol here. And down at the bottom here, you'll notice you have a graph. You can plot your supply voltage and RSSI, which, like I said, my receiver isn't being powered, you know, from a BEC or anything right now, so it's not gonna show a supply voltage, and there's no transmitter signal present, so there's gonna be no RSSI. We'll come back to that in a moment though. And you have a spectrum analyzer on the tab at the top here. When you click run analyzer, you'll see you start to plot a graph here, and you have your the blue is your average, green is a minimum, red is max, which you can, there's a button here to set your noise reference. When you do that, it'll draw a yellow line here and set your noise with no signal present, so that whenever you enable a transmission source, like for example, I turn on my radio now, you should see the spikes start to come up. And if you want to, it's just plotting your average right now, you want to recheck the box plot max, it'll store the max position of those spikes. You can see the actual channels, which is my Dragonlink radio hopping, you know, it's channel hopping. You can see the individual channels here relative to your noise reference, which we said a moment ago, which would be pretty handy for if you just wanted to double check if you're having a problem with some interference on your UHF receiver on board your airplane. You can power up just your receiver using USB and set your noise reference, then power the rest of your airplane up and see what kind of spikes you're getting. And then you could, you know, eliminate one thing at a time until you found what's generating that spike, or, you know, get rid of that component, change it, shield it, move it, you know, do whatever you need to do to get that spike to go away, which, so that your receiver doesn't see it anymore. So this could actually be a pretty handy tool for tweaking your installation or troubleshooting, you know, things like that. So we'll go ahead and go back to the main tab here, which we're showing my RSSI right now is showing approximately 60%, which I don't have a receiver on my antenna. On my I don't have an antenna on my receiver, I'm sorry, you can see there. So my RSSI is gonna be a little bit lower than 100%. But if we do screw on a antenna, you'll see the RSSI goes right up to max. Which it's a good idea to leave an antenna on the receiver if you have your beacon enabled anyway, which there's a note on Dragonlink's website that they've done extensive testing without a receiver, but as a general rule of thumb, you want to have an antenna on a transmitter anytime. Which, if you enable the beacon and you think you might be hitting failsafe during your ground setup or whatever, just make sure you have an antenna connected. It's a good idea. And you'll notice here these little sliders for each individual channel. Now that we actually have a signal from the transmitter, you can see I'm moving my channel 2, which is my elevator stick. You can see this slider here actually moves to indicate that it's getting a signal from your transmitter. You can do the same with the aileron stick, channel 1, rudder stick, channel 4, throttle, channel 3. And it could be useful for troubleshooting or mapping your channels or whatever. It's just good thing to have. And so that's basically your setup. If you configure how you need it, and I'm gonna go ahead and power down my radio, which you should see my RSSI fall off to 0. And we'll set my timer here on my phone. So I'm just gonna set this so I'll know when my 5 minutes is coming up. And in the meantime, all right, now as you can see here, we have the receiver which has gone in a failsafe. We turned off the transmitter a moment ago. We have a timer here just so I know when my 5 minutes is coming up, when we can expect it to start the beacon. And we're going to listen to that beacon using my Radio Shack handheld scanner. It is a Pro 67 model, just an old cheap analog scanner, nothing special. Powered up. I use it to scan air traffic controller bands sometimes, occasionally, which it's scanning right now. Set my squelch. Sure, there's not a lot of traffic on those bands out here in the middle of nowhere anyway. But what we'll do is set it to manual, and as I showed you a minute ago, it should be on 425 megahertz. So we'll set that. And we want to... Sorry about that, but I want to get it tuned on to exactly 425. Alright, we'll just give that a moment. And wait for the timer to run out. And then you should hear that beacon start. Alright, and now you can hear that beacon, which is on, like I said, 425 megahertz. You hear it just, it's a repeating tone. And if I power my transmitter back up, you see the blue light comes back on the receiver to indicate a signal and the beacon stops. So we'll go ahead and power this stuff down. And that's basically a quick look at the receiver and just a quick run through the configuration, give you a basic idea of what options it has, what it's capable of. And one thing I know some people will want to know is it's a mini receiver, so how does it compare in size to some other small receivers? This one is a 9-channel Hawkeye receiver, the DTF UHF. This particular one needs a little filter to get analog RSSI, which I've built there. But other than the filter, it's basic. It's pretty comparable to the size there. A little bit shorter, a little bit wider, a little bit thicker, but not much. Another common small receiver people use on mini quads is the FreeSky D4R2, which is a 4-channel 2.4 gigahertz receiver. And this, a lot of people use this when they like it. It's really small, really light. You get PPM out. And it's about the same height and width as the Dragonlink receiver. A little bit shorter. And of course you'll use smaller antennas. But once again, this is a full range UHF Dragonlink receiver and claims the same performance as a full size 12-channel receivers, which, as we know, these are capable of massive ranges, more than probably 99% of the people in the hobby are ever going to fly. Personally, I've been out to 8 miles with the full-size 12-channel one. I haven't actually flown this one yet, but we will later in another video. You're simply not going to get that out of these 2.4 gigahertz receivers. And personally, I've used the Hawkeye. I've been out to around 3 or 4 miles with them. I use a small on the 4-channel one, or 6-channel, I'm sorry, on my mini quad. But I get the momentary little glitches and fail saves here and there, even at close range with these. They're not as good at rejecting noise, and they generally don't perform as good as the Dragonlink receivers. But the Dragonlink receivers were always larger and heavier, which were, especially on a small micro quad, they're not ideal. But these intend to change that. So in the next video, we'll probably mount it up and fly it, do some range tests, and Maybe power up the old version 1 Dragonlink that I still have here and use occasionally. We might power that up and see how they reject noise. Do a little bit of comparison on some of that stuff. But for now, like I said, that's a basic quick look at what you get and what it can do. And I like it so far.